What's up, YouTube? Today's a new day. We're gonna start on installing these compressors. I'm gonna pretty much just jump right into it. I've already started installing a few things. Got the upper mount fully bolted in. Put a little blue Loctite on the threads. Plus use the lock washer. Already got the airbags installed, and that's pretty much it. There's a bar, and I'll show y'all that here in a second, that was actually, it's like a cross member for the spare tire. I've already cleaned that up, stripped it down, because I was using that to mount, to hold the compressor that I had in place, the single compressor. I'm going to dual compressors now, and I'm gonna use that same spot, I believe, and I'm gonna have to change some mounting, just a slight tad. The only issue I'm concerned about is the top head of the motor. Here's the original motor I had in it. This thing right here was really close to the wood. And so if I adjust anything and go up a little higher, I could have issues coming in contact with the wood. So I got to figure that out. I don't want to go too much higher up. I don't remember how much clearance I had. It wasn't much. Maybe a quarter inch, half inch. I'm not sure, but we're gonna figure this out because the way I mounted it was nice. It was worked out okay, but I want to slightly change it a bit. So we're gonna have to mess with all that. So I'm about to get into it. But first things first, let's open up this dual compressor box and show you what's in the box. All right, here we go. So I got the, this is the black set. This is 444C, it's a dual pack. Switch suspensions where I bought this from. When I was at the Lone Star Throwdown earlier this year, and I bought this fuel pack for $250, cash money. Got some decals, filters, stuff like that. And here's the main compressors here. All right, here we go. The two compressors. If you do like the chrome, they make chrome. So they're nice. It's the exact same compressor. These are just black. That's got kind of a black sheathing. And my chrome had that stainless steel braided hose. Yeah, let's see that. Stainless steel braided hose on the chrome one. Adjust that camera. Good spot, and it's got like a black sheeting like you would see on a wiring harness or something. So that's nice. Bag out of the way here. Yeah, these are really nice units here. I like them. That little port right there is for the, you should get a, open this up. Should get a little filters. Yeah, these are the things here. And that screws in there. So it's an air filter. So we're gonna go ahead. This is pretty much what you get in the kit, as you can see. And of course you got mounting hardware. It does come with that. Like the filters, and you can do like if you want to remote mount the filter, it comes with some fittings as well. If you want to like move the filter somewhere else, it does not come with hose to do that. So if you want to do that, you'll have to make your own hose. Yeah, wire's already on there. I already got a heat shrink on the ground, and got the little vinyl covering on the positive wire there. So really nice compressors. I've never had any issues with this one, but I'm running a 7-gallon tank, so it makes it a little bit more challenging to fill up. I know if I'm going to go somewhere for the weekend, like if I'm going to take the truck out, I'll empty the air out of the tank. I got a Schrader valve on the tank that I used to I drain the tank, get all the condensation out of there, and then I'd fill it up as much as I could with my compressor. And then I would let the single compressor fill up the rest. So the single compressor lasts this long airing up the tank, and I've aired it up from empty tank to all the way full. It takes a while doing that. It's probably not good on the compressor. That's why I'm going dual. So now we're gonna move over there to the frame and start figuring out how we're gonna mount this stuff. So let's set up the camera over there and go from there. All right, guys. So before I showed you anything, I had to kind of quarterback through some situations here. I'm still using this original bar that I made. However, you can kind of tell right there that I bent it up. I didn't realize it, or I wasn't paying attention when I put all this together the first time. Obviously, this rod here, or this cross member that comes from the factory, is raised more elevated than the frame is. So when I was bolting it up, it was actually tweaking that front bracket right here. I was actually putting this bracket that's in the front right here. So here's the one I took off. I don't know if you can see that, but it got bent. So, and I didn't realize that until I was looking at it. And I was wondering, why did it get bent? That's why. So what I did was I kind of marked it a little bit right there, and I went ahead and bent it to where it comes up there pretty even. So I think it looks good there. And you're probably wondering why it's mounted up under, why just not mounted on top. Well, obviously they come with the little isolator bushings right here. I took those out, and I'm using some rubber washers that I got from Home Depot. And the reason I'm doing that is, yeah, you could mount it on top of just set it up top, screw your holes, and mount it in there. However, unless you raise the bed floor, you're not gonna, the wood portion of the bed is gonna hit on top of this compressor. So that's why it's done the way I'm doing it now. So it's kind of hard to say. Let me get my light in here. Maybe I'll see. So I got those washers in between the bracket I made and the actual compressor bracket that comes in there, along with them there as well. So I'm thinking it should work just fine that way. It's going to give it a little bit of cushion with those rubber washers, and I'll probably put a couple of rubber washers in between the cross member and the little bracket I made on both ends. And that should take care of that. So now that everything is the way it is and the way I want it, I'm gonna go ahead and make a duplicate of this bar here and do the same thing to the other side. I'll have to, you know, drill new holes, mounting holes, and all that stuff. But once that's done, then I can take this off and paint it. Now, this is how I'm doing it, and there's two reasons why I'm doing this. One reason is it kind of protects, these compressors are kind of protected from anything that might be on the road, because there's brackets that they make that mount on the side of the frame, and those are fine as well. They're easier to get to and mount and all that stuff. But if anything comes across there, if you have a blowout or something, you could hit that compressor and damage it. So I was thinking up in here, kind of tucked away, was nice. Still easy to get to. My leader hose here still connects to the tank, because I got the tank right here. I got a 7-gallon tank that I bought, or I got when that Easy Air Ride kit that I installed a few years ago. If you haven't seen those videos, check them out. They're a few years old. My editing not that great, but you get the gist of what I did. And I have the advantage, or anybody with a long bed has the advantage, because you have all this frame rail sticking out, so that air tank fits nice in here. And of course, when I put it in, you'll see everything hooked up with the hoses and see how I route it. But y'all short bed guys won't have none of this sticking out, so you could technically do the compressor thing. I just don't know where you would put your tank, so you probably have to do something on the outside of the frame. So long bed guys, you probably can do what I'm doing here if you like how I'm mounting this. This is how I'm going to do it for now. Maybe down in the future, I'll probably temporarily move, you know, maybe go to 2 3-gallon tanks and compressor bracket mounting system and do it that way. Right now I got that 7 gallon tank, so we're gonna run dual compressors to fill that up. So I'm gonna go ahead and cut, bend, make the holes, everything I gotta do to make that other bar I made, or the other bar I need to make for the other compressor. And once all that's done, I can go ahead and get it painted, and we'll go from there. Bar cut. This is actually 12 inches. Already got it bent. So now all I got to do is start making at least the two mounting holes to mount it in place. And go from there. All right, got the two holes made. That was a bit of a challenge doing that, but it's done. So now what I need to do is make the two holes on the frame to support the front of the compressor. And then the two holes on this bar slash bracket I made to support the back of it. And I need to make sure I get the distance correct to match the other side. That way I know for sure my hose has no issues connecting to the tank. So we'll go ahead and get all that going, and we will go from there. Got all the holes made. I'm not gonna install screws on these last two because I'm about to take all this apart. There's one last thing I need to do to the bracket here. I gotta do a little clearancing inside the back here, and I'll show you what I'm talking about, because I'm gonna be installing some of those rubber washers I was talking about earlier for a little bit of insulation. So I'm gonna go ahead and take all this down, and we'll go to the work table, and I'll show you what I'm talking about. All right, so the last thing I needed to do was kind of thin this spot out right here on the bracket I made, because in mounting this, obviously there's no issues metal to metal, but I'm going to be installing these thin rubber washers in between the two metals to kind of give it some sort of cushion, isolating as it vibrates. You can't install those rubber washers without thinning that spot out. Obviously this is 3/16 steel, so you could probably get away with 1/8 inch fixed steel and probably wouldn't even have to do this, but this is the way I'm doing it. So that was the final step. So now all I have to do, test fit everything, make sure it looks good to go, and go ahead and start painting all this stuff. I still got to remove the cross member off the chassis and remove the other bracket, because I did the exact same thing on that bracket as well. Next time you see these, both compressors will be installed, everything will be painted, and we'll be moving on to installing the tank. All right guys, I got a lot of work to do, so I'm gonna get to it. All right guys, here we go. About to do the 80 amp relay that I got from Viair. Got this at Amazon. This is what the relay looks like. Pretty simple. Comes with a schematic. Obviously you can compare
The location I've decided on is right there where that steel bar is. That's a leftover piece of scrap from when I did the two bars that are holding up the compressors. So that's pretty much what it's going to look like when it's all said and done. I'll paint the bar as well, but I like this spot because it's centered to the compressors. So, and I can use most of the wire length for the positive. I will have to change the terminal, the female terminals right here, to something more of a ring style. Other than that, that's really all I have to do. Same thing with my pressure switch, and then figure out where I'm going to ground it. I did get 6-gauge wire from Amazon as well. It's 25-foot roll, that's the part number. Nice thing about it, made in USA. So if you're interested in getting some cable, and I think they have other sizes as well, you go to Amazon, look for that brand, and go from there. So 6-gauge, this is a 25-foot roll, it's good for 100 amps. Now obviously, from the battery, even though this is a long bed truck, from the battery all the way to here, it's not gonna be 25 feet. It's probably gonna be roughly 12 to 15, somewhere in there. So that should be plenty for supporting these two compressors. The only thing I do need to get that I forgot to get is I need to get an 80 amp, not relay, but fuse and fuse holder. That's the only thing I need to get, because you can see here on the floor, the old 8-gauge wire, that's the old fuse holder, but it's a 40 amp fuse holder. Oh, look who stopped by to say hi. Little 85 Mongoose, California. Yeah, I need to put her back in the shed, but she thought she'd stop by and say hi. Another thing I want to show y'all is this is a four-way I got as from Amazon as well. It's a four-way female, quarter inch MPT, I think is what they call it. So I used to have one here when I was just running a single compressor, and then I had it blocked off here and I had a gauge here. It's good to have a tank pressure gauge so you know where you're at. So that's where the compressor is gonna be running there. The reason why I have this plugged, what I'm thinking I'm going to do is put a air chuck there. That way I can run an air line if I need to air a tire up or run a blow gun or whatever I want to do. So here's the other four-way. And I had a three-way here, and the pressure switch was here, and I had the Schrader valve here. And at first I was going to put the pressure switch here, but I decided, you know, with you got, you know, your tire slinging up stuff, something could hit the switch and break it off. So moved it back here, moved the Schrader valve here. I haven't tightened anything up yet because I don't know if I'll have to take any of this back apart. So far, I think the wiring on the pressure switch will be okay. Maybe I'll use this existing hole. We'll see how I do everything once I finalize it all. But for now, you're pretty much caught up to where I'm at. I'm gonna go ahead and start getting this relay mounted and that bar mounted to the other bars and start getting all this wiring done. All right, went ahead and made the decision, went ahead and got some lines made. Cost me about $40 to have these two made. So hopefully they work and don't leak. I still save the original ones because I do want to go stainless, and so I may make my own someday, get a flaring tool and all that stuff. Went ahead and got the 6-gauge cable already pretty much ran through the frame. But first things first, I'm gonna go ahead and install this line, the long one that goes down the frame. And then once that's established and installed, then I'll know exactly where I need to put the clamps for the air lines and the power cable. So I'm gonna go ahead and do that, guys, and I'm gonna get back at it. All right, guys, I wanna stop and take a little bit of a moment and show y'all where I'm at. So I got the new brake lines already pretty much installed. Had to make a few tweaks here and there on bends, but when you're doing the C-notch, you will have to remove this, that lower brace that's on your, that's riveted to your shock cross member. And in doing so, you lose that little mounting spot for your brake line. So what I did here is I borrowed this upper shock mount bolt area and I used an insulator clamp, as you can see right there. It's not rubbing on the, should not rub the shock because the shock is leaning away from that clamp. I also did a couple of clamps on each end for the driver's side rear bag. I'm probably gonna drill a hole and put a clamp right there somewhere in the middle, or I may even do two, one on each end. We'll see how I do that. Got the 6-gauge power cable already routed through the frame. It's already going through all the clamps that are on the frame. I may have to make one or two more on the bottom, drill some holes, but then start zip tying everything. I just want to go ahead and tidy all that up, get all my fittings on the brake lines tightened up, get all that done, tidy up everything under the cab. Just wanted to take a moment, get you up to speed of where I'm at. This is kind of hard to film all this little stuff like this, so I'm doing the best I can. I may just have to do it and then stop and show y'all what I did. So I'm gonna go ahead and get back at it. All right, it's a new morning. So I went ahead and, like I said earlier, tidied up all the lines. All the brake lines have been tightened. Got everything zip tied, clamped where I want it to be. Went ahead and installed my new brake lines for the rear end. Oh, looks like I got a decal to remove. I'll take care of that. So all that's installed. Looks out pretty good. Got all the fittings with Loctite. I'm gonna show y'all what y'all supposed to use for airline. Loctite 545 is what you're supposed to use. 5452 is the same thing, it's just fast curing. I even think it says that. Yeah, fast cure. So you can use either or. The 545, I believe, needs to set up overnight. So this stuff would be good for, like, if you need to fix something and then get going. So I would recommend just getting this one over the other one. But this is what you're supposed to use. You can use whatever you really want to use, but this is the best stuff. This is what's highly recommended amongst a lot of shops. So, but for now, we're going to set up the camera and go ahead and start working on all this relay setup, getting all these wires installed and set up and ready to go. So I'm going to go do that and we'll go from there. All right, pretty much went ahead and mounted it off camera. Looks pretty good. Now that that's in spot, nice and sturdy. Now I gotta figure out all this wiring. All right guys, it's more personal preference, but on these ring terminals that come with that colored plastic piece, remove that. Just pull that off, it pulls off pretty easy. A lot of times I'll just put this in a vise, or you can take some pliers and just pull this off. If they're a little bit stubborn, just use a razor blade or something to cut it away. They just look ugly. And then just take a little bit of heat shrink, stick it on the wire, and when you crimp it, then you just slide it over, heat it on there, and it'll look a lot cleaner and nicer. Just a little tech tip. It's more of a aesthetic tip than it is a tech tip, but that's what I'm gonna do. Just thought I'd share that with y'all. All right, so what I had to do here is replace this bolt. It was a 7/16, now it's a 3/8, so I could fit this insulator clamp. And it's kind of protecting the wire and lifting it up away from that sharp edge on this cross member, so that's a nice thing there. Also on the ground wire for the compressor, I'm not gonna cut it down. I was going to, or I thought about doing it, but what I'm gonna do is go ahead and kind of fold it in half like that and just do this. That's the one of the ground, that was my ground spot when I had a single compressor and that 40 amp relay was on this side, so I grounded everything there. So I'm gonna do the same thing to the other side. Whoops. I'm gonna go ahead and fold that wire in half, and I gotta make a hole so I can probably use this quarter 20 with one of these toothy looking star washers. Probably have to remove some of the paint to get a good ground. But that's what we're gonna do on this side. then all I have to do is make an actual wire, ground wire for the relay, and then just choose left or right, whichever side I want to ground the relay on. It doesn't really matter. It'll go from there. The last thing I'm probably going to do, I really don't like using that stuff, but it is kind of nice at times. So I think I'm going to go ahead and use that plastic conduit. I think I have some somewhere. If I don't, I'll just go get some. That way I can put all this wiring inside there, and it, you know, keeps it all bundled up, protected. And it, you know, as the wire vibrates, it's not going to be rubbing any, you know, like screw threads or anything. So I don't want to have any of the wires, you know, get the insulation get rubbed off and start shorting out, causing issues. So I'm gonna go ahead and do this side, switch the bolt to the 3/8. I already got the bolt ready to go. Got a clamp, and then go ahead and start doing that. So, all right, guys, I'm gonna get back at it. All right, I had to call an audible. The clamps weren't working. What they were doing was basically pulling the wire for the compressor, basically the positive wire, too far away from the relay to reach without doing this stretch pull method. And I didn't want to do all that, so switched over. I had a couple of these 3/8 Allen button head screws. I need to get a couple of them that are a little longer. I can't use a lock washer right now, but for now they're in spot. So that's what we're gonna do. That way there's a smooth radius, nothing sharp, no sharp edges. Should chafe the wires or anything. Like I said earlier, I think I'm gonna run that plastic conduit. It's not my favorite thing to use, but it will keep these wires nice and protected. That's my GoPro camera powering off. I'm using my iPhone right now. Anyways, so now that I've done that, I'm gonna go ahead and start making the end, change the ends on the power cables for the compressor, and go ahead and make my battery cable, cut it to length, make the terminal for that. We should be pretty much done. All right, guys, I'm gonna get to it. A little tech tip moment here. When you're making terminal ends, go ahead and use a little heat shrink. That way when you finalize it, you can crimp it up and it looks really nice and clean. Looks, has a professional look to it. Just slide it over the, make sure you slide it over the wire first. There's that terminal end, just pull those stupid plastic things off. They look hideous. Stick it on there. I like to make it where the wire is just the right length. What I do is crimp it. Top side here. What I did there, put that heat shrink over it. These type of lighters are really good for this kind of stuff. Heat it up. It's nice and neat now, so now that's ready to go. Those ends, so that'll work there. All right, so we got those made. So now I need to cut this down. It needs a smaller terminal. And then I gotta make the battery cable, so that'll be the last one. That one's gonna be a little different because it's 6-gauge. So I won't be able to use a regular handheld crimper. So let me get all this going and go from there. All right, guys, I still got a little bit of tidying up to do. It's not permanent, but everything's hooked up, so let's test this out and see if these compressors turn on. Thank you.
not have a fuse yet. I got it on order at Amazon. Hopefully it comes in tomorrow. Well, guys, there you go. Got two compressors that now make a little bit of noise. Yeah, I'm gonna go ahead and clean all this up. This ain't 100% the way I want it, but it's getting close. And once I get all that done, I'll show you all the final look, and we will go from there. All right, guys, I'm gonna get to it. All right, guys, there's the finished product, pretty much. All the conduit fit in there. Kind of taped some spots. Just kind of secure it in place. Kind of reduced it in there and slipped it inside here a little bit. So now the wiring's protected from any sharp edges, screw ends. I'm not really worried about that. Same thing here. The nice thing about it, look how clean that is up under here. You don't see any wiring except for that one little wire going to the compressor. I mean the relay. All the screws match. They're all stainless steel, so they shouldn't rust. So if somebody looked under this truck, this is what they would see. Obviously they're not gonna see the wiring because once the bed's on top, not gonna see it. That little bar, you know, makes a good wiring harness trough. Looks nice. I may not be the greatest wiring guy in the world, but I've seen worse and I'm satisfied with that. I can live with that, and I think it's gonna last a long time. So pretty much done. I'm gonna go ahead and wrap it up. I gotta take that relay back off and that bar and go ahead and paint it, and then this will be officially done back here. And then the only thing left to do as far as wiring goes is when I get that 80 amp fuse, I'll do the battery. And when I do that, I'll show you how I did that. And pretty much it. All right, guys, I'm gonna get to it. Just wanted to show you the finished product. All right, YouTube, I'm gonna pretty much call it on this video. It's been pretty much a two-day process just doing the cables and the brake lines and all that stuff, but it's a part of it. It's a part of it. It's a tedious process, so. Got all the new brake lines in, got all the fittings tight. I still need to fill up the master cylinder with brake fluid and bleed the rear brakes. Still got to put gear oil in the rear end and take care of a few other odds and ends. I'll probably do all that stuff off camera. So I really like the way that relay location turned out. I like the way the wiring looks. Especially from the bottom side, you hardly can't see anything. It looks really nice. So pretty much the next video is going to be drive shaft. I'm going to tear that thing apart. I'm going to strip it down, clean it up, and paint it. And then I'm going to put it all back together with new U-joints and a new carrier bearing. And I'm going to show as much footage as I can throughout the whole process. And then once that thing is done, hopefully I can get that installed. Install the exhaust. Then I have a new intermediate parking brake cable I need to put on. And then hopefully I can get this thing on the ground and take it outside. Because it needs a bath. It needs a much needed bath. Even with that car cover, that dust got everywhere. It's all under the hood and everything. So I'm hoping to do that. Get everything done this weekend. Get this thing on the ground. Because after that process is done, next stop is working on that bed. We've got to tear it down, remove all that old wood, and go from there. But for now, we're not at that stage yet. So for now, finish this up, get that drive shaft going, and go from there. So if this is your first time watching and you're new to the channel, go ahead and check out my previous videos on the C-notch, on the disc brake, engine swap, all that stuff. Like the videos you like, and stay up to date with my 66 C10. I got a lot more stuff I'm going to be doing in the future. So
you know, go ahead and subscribe, that way you can stay up to date. All right, guys, I'm pretty much called on this one. Like I always say, until then, thanks for watching.